G'day, Auntie Mahari here. And in this video, what you're really going to be hearing is an interview I did, a couple of years back now, I think, with an amazing woman who was a pioneer and started out first with anxiety, helping and treating anxiety, and also then moving toward depression as well. So Lucinda Bassett, a well-known author. She was the founder and CEO of one of the most successful self-help companies in the United States called the Midwest Center for Stress and Anxiety, Inc. And her audio program, which I happen to benefit from many years ago in my recovery from BPD, covered in 95. Sorry, I have to keep inserting that. I'm just reading a bio a little bit here. Her audio program, Lucinda Bassett's audio program, Attacking Anxiety and Depression, is used worldwide by healthcare professionals and hospitals, organizations and hospitals. And just so happened that I got that program in, the early 1980s or thereabouts, or was it a little bit more towards the end of the 80s? Can't remember now, but it was called Attacking Anxiety, I think, at the time, and then has been expanded to include depression as well. I'm not really 100% sure. All I know is that Lucinda Bassett's work really, really helped me in many ways. And so the books that she's written, the first book I ever found of hers, I think I found these two at once, and I read them both, and they were really helpful. From Panic to Power, and that was the main one. The first one that I found and read. And she's also, Lucinda Bassett is also the author of Life Without Limits, Truth Be Told, which is a memoir and a really moving book. And what I was interviewing at the time that I was interviewing Lucinda Bassett, where I have my Blog Talk Radio show, which is still there, but I've never had time to go back to it. So I thought, I'm going to do more interviews on YouTube, and they'll mostly be more in video, they'll be in video moving forward, hopefully. But I'm going to put up my Blog Talk Radio interviews from before, some really relevant ones that I think will help people with a lot of things. And so in this interview that I had done with Lucinda Bassett, the book that she had out at the time and was talking about the most was called The Solution. And so the other thing I need to say here is that, this is going to be audio that you're going to hear in a video platform, so I'll probably just have a picture of her books up or something like that. But if you've ever had a problem, or you have a problem right now with anxiety and or depression as part of BPD, or standalone issues or unresolved things from your childhood, whatever the reasons, right, I think you'll find this a really empowering interview. And I think that Lucinda Bassett is a really empowering person who at the time of this interview had recent tragedy in her life and a lot to cope with. And I just always found her an inspiration. It was an honor for me to be able to interview her. So I'm going to be bringing many more interviews to my YouTube channel that will be done in video going forward. But from a plethora of people, as I get back to networking again, as I was doing when I was doing the Blog Talk Radio show, to interview a wide variety of people on a wide variety of subjects, professionals, authors, other people going through things, and that sort of thing. So this interview, I just wanted to say also, it's going to play like my Blog Talk Radio interview did, from beginning to end. So you'll hear the introduction to that Blog Talk Radio show, which I'm no longer having time to do interviews on. So that's why I'm moving it over here to YouTube. So what you're going to hear there, though, is to reference a website, psychewhisperer.com, which I didn't keep the domain. These are up in audio format at, I believe, Blog Talk Radio still, if you searched. But And then it's more germane in some interviews than this one, but I'm not sure if I... No, okay. So I just wanted to say, not necessarily this interview, but some upcoming interviews I'm going to share from my Blog Talk Radio interviews here on YouTube. I have a website up called biopsychiatry.ca, which refutes a lot of the biopsychiatry, the medicating of personality disorders, the unbelievable connections between big pharma and these studies, which are biased from the beginning, and there's no such thing as a brain disorder. And like Robert Whitaker so aptly put it in his book, Anatomy of an Epidemic, quote, there's no such thing as a chemical imbalance in the brain until and unless you take psychiatric medication, unquote. And if you're somebody who's on a lot of medications right now, for like borderline personality disorder or some other things that really the majority of professionals believe are counterindicated, you know, for the treatment of like borderline personality disorder and maybe other conditions, but not all. So point is, anyway, this interview isn't about that. It's about anxiety. But I just wanted to let people know, I'll put it in the bottom, that maybe check out my biopsychiatry.ca site. And there's other references to interviews there, but they'll be coming here to YouTube too. Two interviews I did with Dr. Niall McLaren, who is a psychiatrist in Australia, who is really working hard to, he finally did get to publish 3 books, and he's working really hard and has been for a long time to refute the biopsychiatry model, to refute the idea of a brain disorder, to refute the idea put forward with that you know, somehow it's like your brain made you do it and what are you supposed to do, but it's just not true, okay? And so as many professionals as Dr. Niall McLaren, who talk about all the problems of psychiatry today and where it really needs to like turn a corner and you know, stop all this medication nonsense, not that he doesn't say in some cases, of course, there's reasons for medication, but in so many more there aren't. And so anyway, those interviews will be up soon here, and that website is biopsychiatry.ca, and Dr. Niall McLaren has written something there, and I have some other videos up, and I've also interviewed Dr. John Breeding. He's a psychologist from Texas, and by the way, a shout out to Texas. What a horrible storm. We hope that many more people than not are still going to be rescued and safe. And things just seem to be getting worse, especially in Houston. So anyway, let's hope they get better real soon. And prayers to those people. This is August 31st, so 2017, when this is happening in Texas. A whole lot of flooding and unfortunately people losing their lives. And last I heard, something blew up because of the water, and so the problems just keep growing there, unfortunately, and hopefully that will change. But anyway, Dr. John Breeding is a psychologist from in Texas, in the USA, and I have other interviews that I did with some other really interesting, I think, and really helpful people. So please, you know, check back to my YouTube here, because I'm going to be putting them up, as soon as I can when I have time. And so this one, though, has nothing to do with the biopsychiatry aspect of anything. This is Lucinda Bassett on anxiety and depression and a tragedy in her life and coping. And so I hope you'll find this interesting and helpful. Her book, The Solution, was a good, great book. She may have written something in the meantime. I don't know. And the other thing I'd like to just say is, so when you hear reference at the beginning of every one of these interviews coming up to my YouTube channel, psychewhisperer.com, I didn't keep the domain, so I don't know what's on it. I don't, you know, so you can just wait for the interviews to come up and leave your comments, as always, below the video, which is like video audio, if you know what I mean. But yeah, and I will have many more interviews coming that will be actually, hopefully, video and not audio. But these are older ones I did maybe in the last, 2 to 5 years. I really don't know, unless I can find the dates on them. So this is Lucinda Bassett, with her book that was currently new at the time of that interview called The Solution, and talking about anxiety and depression and sharing some really tragic experience in her own life. And she was somebody that suffered from panic and anxiety attacks a long time ago in her life and found a way through and then created the Midwest Center and went on to do so many other things and is a author as well, like I said. And so her Attacking Anxiety program helped me immensely when I discovered in, I think it was like somewhere in the 80s, I really don't know, because like if I say early 80s and it wasn't out yet, I don't know, I just can't remember. Anyway, coming up is that interview that will be audio, making reference to the Blog Talk Radio show, but that show is, I think, still up over there, but I don't do any new interviews. So they're all going to get uploaded here. I welcome subscribers and anyone who finds my channel to stay tuned for the interviews coming up here for your convenience, okay? And so now, my interview with Lucinda Bassett, author of From Panic to Power, other books, but in this interview, had just released the book, The Solution.
Blog Talk Radio. Welcome to the Psyche Whisperer Radio Show. I'm your host, AJ Mahari. Psyche Whisperer Radio Show examines a wide variety of topics, interviewing eclectic guests, all to bring to you and provide for you thought-provoking contemplation to awaken your awareness even more fully. Everything that unfolds in our life experience speaks to both our individual and our collective psyche, breath, soul, mind, life. Be sure to visit our website at psychewhisperer.com, follow us on Facebook, and or subscribe to this radio show on iTunes. Thanks for joining us today, and I hope you'll find today's show interesting. And on today's episode of the Psyche Whisperer Radio Show, I'm honored to have as a guest Lucinda Bassett, who is the founder and president of the Midwest Center for Stress and Anxiety. And the motto of the Midwest Center for Stress and Anxiety is fostering strength, character, and self-empowerment. And now I'd like to just play for you a little audio clip of Lucinda Bassett talking about anxiety and the symptoms of anxiety, along with a bit about her attacking anxiety program.
When you look up the definition of anxiety in Webster's, it says anxiety is a painful uneasiness of mind, and boy is that true, over an anticipated ill. We anticipate something bad's going to happen, often accompanied by body symptoms such as heart palpitations, and that's when your heart pounds so fast you feel like it's just going to pop right out of your chest, or feelings of nausea or diarrhea or upset stomach where you feel like you might be sick or have to find a bathroom. Another symptom would include dizziness or spacey feelings, like you feel like you're just not there. That was a big symptom for me. Or sweaty palms or inner nervousness, or feelings that something awful is going to happen, or a feeling that you just need to run but you don't know why. These are all symptoms of anxiety disorder. And did you know that 85% of the time, people go off to their family doctor complaining of migraines or muscle tension or difficulty concentrating or just feelings of uneasiness that they can't really define, and it's anxiety disorder. I would suggest that you go to your doctor and have a physical. Afraid they might find something? afraid they might not. This is typical, but it puts your mind at ease when you go to the doctor and they take all the tests, and 85 to 90% of the time, they don't find anything. It's anxiety related. The unfortunate thing, though, is they may, in their 5 or 10 minutes with you, give you an antidepressant or anti-anxiety medication and say, this is your solution. If that happens, I urge you to be cautious about medications. Some medications can be very beneficial, and we'll talk about those later on in the program, and we do talk about them on the audio cassette. But the problem with medication is that for too many people don't want to take medication. If you're like me, you don't even want to take medication. You're afraid of medication. You don't want to become dependent on a medication to get through your day or an airplane flight. And that's the problem. Sometimes people do become dependent on these medications. They end up saying, well, as long as I have my benzodiazepine in my pocket, I can get on the plane or I can drive. But the problem is, we are creative people, and it's time we stop looking at people with anxiety as people with a problem who need to be on medication to fix it. That's not true. You're not someone with a problem. You're someone who's chock full of potential. You're creative. You're intelligent. You're sensitive. You're a perfectionist, and you're a worrier, but you're very analytical, and you're a very, very intuitive person. And these are traits that when they're turned inward, they can make you sick. But when you turn them outward where they belong, they can take you to a whole new level of living. And you can do things you only dreamed of doing. And that's what I've done with my anxiety. Little did I know, when I had severe panic disorder and anxiety and agoraphobia, I had it all, that I was creating a roadmap for other people that would show them how they too could overcome their anxiety on their own. You know, I have to tell you, a lot of the reason we're on such a campaign is that we're so frustrated with what the medical community hasn't done. And the pharmaceutical companies are making an effort to help people help themselves with these drugs, but unfortunately, they want you to take these medications because that's how they make their money. We want you to recover. If medication is part of that recovery for you, so be it. But ask your doctor, be informed, know what you're taking, know what the side effects are, and know what it's going to do to you and for you. Unfortunately, some of the benzodiazepines out there can take away your creative edge. Some of the antidepressants can take away your sex drive. And there's a host of other symptoms and side effects that these medications can cause or create. So just be well informed. You don't ever want to go off your medication without consulting your doctor or without your doctor's assistance. But the goal in this program is for you to get off of, at least cut down on, but eventually get off of your anti-anxiety medication and possibly and probably your antidepressants. This program is not just for people with panic disorder or agoraphobia. Everyone would benefit from the skills in the Attacking Anxiety program because they teach you how to be more in control of your emotions, more in control of the way you think, more in control of your life. And couldn't we all use that? This program, Attacking Anxiety, is going to make you a better mother, a better father, a better spouse, a better employee, a better anything.
And I first came in contact with Lucinda's work, not just recently because, you know, I found out about her latest book and got contacted about blogging about it. No, but because years ago myself, I was really trapped in this cycle of, I guess it was depression back then, but I knew it more as anger and rage. But I had such anxiety, panic attacks and anxiety attacks years ago in my life. And so it must have been in about 1993, 94, that I got the program, Lucinda Bassett's Attacking Anxiety program. And, you know, I could give a testimonial right here, but I'm telling you, it was fabulous, and it changed my life. And so I'm just so honored to be able to talk to Lucinda today because I know how much she has to offer. And so for anyone listening with anxiety or depression, stress issues, feeling like you're paralyzed in your life or too afraid to do anything or whatever situation you may be in where you're really being blocked by anxiety, depression, stress, or a combination of those, all of what that can mean in your life, Lucinda Bassett, she knows how you feel. She's been there, and she made it out, and she's been helping other people make it out, so to speak, heal and move on in their lives for many years now. And I think that, you know, she now has out, I believe that the Midwest Center now has a program. It's now called Breaking Free from Anxiety and Depression. But But the one that I was involved with and still do own, as a matter of fact, was called Attacking Anxiety. And one of the most powerful things in that program, though there was so much information and so much I needed to learn, and it was all right there, and there was exercises to do, and such support in, you know, it was a cassette tape program at the time. And the thing is that the relaxation exercise tape was one of the most powerful things. And truthfully, I have been listening to Lucinda on that tape for, I guess, getting close to 20 years now or something, 15 years. It's something I still do from time to time, not because I'm having anxiety attacks or panic attacks anymore, but just because it's a wonderful way to just take a little vacation, to just relax, to just calm down, to just, it's almost like a meditative break. So, you know, if you're in active anxiety, as I was years ago, it was really about learning how to get out of the cycle that perpetuates that. But now I find that very tape, which I've transferred over to digital, to be so relaxing and so empowering. So anyway, just a little background of my own experience with some of Lucinda's work. And also, I do own her book and have read her book, From Panic to Power, because, you know, I lived a lot of my life, especially my earlier years, in panic. And I'm definitely in need of some personal power and empowerment. And Lucinda Bassett has been there herself. You know, she talks about, there's a bio on her website at stresscenter.com. It's for the Midwest Stress Center. And she says, "My father's battle with alcoholism made for a chaotic household and upbringing. Living on pins and needles, my own battle with anxiety and depression began early in my life. As a 7-year-old, I can remember having bad dreams and a lot of scary thoughts." And that's, you know, Lucinda's experience. And I could also relate. I mean, I really used to think as a little kid there really were monsters under the bed coming to get me, because I lived in a chaotic household with an alcoholic father as well. And Lucinda continues on her website to share, "As a teenager, my problems progressed. While my friends were concentrating on high school, sports, and boys, I was focused on my health problems. I suffered from bouts of irritable bowel syndrome, headaches, nervous stomach, and developed eating disorders. I also experienced these strange periods of unreality. It's hard to describe these eerie, dreamlike periods, but I would feel strangely detached from myself and my surroundings. I worried constantly about everything." And Lucinda also says, "I worried about being liked. I worried that something bad was going to happen to my family. I worried about my health, fearing I had this disease or that illness. It was around my 20s when my world became most limited and intolerable. I was having panic attacks on a daily basis. It wasn't long before I began limiting my activities to avoid these attacks. I had difficulty driving, flying, socializing, even sitting in closed-door meetings at work. I was an emotional roller coaster, frustrating everyone around me with my obsessiveness and negative, irrational thinking." So then Lucinda says, "I visited a doctor after doctor, actually, saw a specialist, psychiatrist, and had just about every medical test known to man at the time. I literally spent a small fortune over 10 years looking for answers and relief from my heart palpitations, headaches, stomach problems, and other problems, yet I wasn't getting any answers." And Lucinda said she was afraid to take medication. She didn't want to become dependent on medication for the rest of her life. She worried about addiction, and she worried about withdrawal and also unpleasant side effects. So in her heart, Lucinda believed that she was alone and completely different from everyone else in the world. And secretly she wondered if she might even be losing her mind. Her anxiety was actually, she says, diagnosed by watching the Today Show. She prayed to God to help her. She pleaded with God to show her one person who'd survive these feelings. She promised she would serve God the rest of her life if only she could discover why she felt so terrified, bewildered, and depressed. The next morning, she was getting ready for work and she turned on the TV set. And she wasn't really watching, but soon she began to tune in. And as she says on her website, there was a woman on the Today Show talking about agoraphobia, anxiety, and depression. She described the personality characteristics: negative, analytical thinkers, perfectionistic, chronic obsessive worriers, and emotionally sensitive. She began describing all the symptoms I was experiencing: racing, seemingly irregular heart rate, dizziness, tightness of the throat, sweating, diarrhea, stomach problems, and feeling bewilderment. She described the fear of losing control and embarrassing yourself in public, and the fear of strange body symptoms. She talked about the fear of choking, of having a heart attack and dying, and fear of losing your mind. And for Lucinda, at that time, she was stunned, frozen in mid-step, and glued to the TV. She couldn't believe that the woman on TV was talking about her. For the first time in her life, Lucinda had a name for what might be affecting her. It was a glimmer of hope. So Lucinda set off to solve her own problem. She went immediately to the library and to the bookstore, taking home every book and journal that she could find about anxiety, agoraphobia, panic attacks, and depression. And over about 6 months, she devoted all of her time to simply understanding herself and this condition. And Lucinda says that what she learned not only saved her life, but also opened the door to a future beyond her wildest dreams. The first thing she learned, however, was most comforting. She learned, if you're listening today with these issues or in your life, the first thing to learn, from this interview is, and from Lucinda, is you're not alone, because that's what Lucinda learned. She learned, I wasn't alone. I wasn't sick or mentally ill or otherwise that different from many other people. In fact, I was among an estimated 30 million Americans suffering from anxiety and depression. And I happen to live in Canada. I could say there's a lot of it. We may only have 33 million, our whole population, but, if you think about, 5 to 10%, there's a lot of people here and probably in every country in the world suffering from anxiety and depression. And so Lucinda goes on to say, as she learned more and more over the following months, she slowly began to take control of her own life. She started to think that her long journey was nearing an end. And, if you want to read more about Lucinda's journey, as she shares on this website, in her bio, on the Midwest Center website, please do check out www.stresscenter.com and just click on About Lucinda Bassett. Because, I could read more of it. I could go on more. But the point is, Lucinda's here for us to actually talk to, listen to, and learn from today, with her latest book, but with a message that she has not only created or defined and been bringing to people and helping people to change their lives for years now, but a message that was and the education she has to provide people, and the insight and the awareness and the empowerment that she first found herself. So, I really believe, as someone myself in the work that I do as a life coach and other things, when we've been through something ourselves, and as Lucinda said, prayed for the answers and then promised to serve God, it's exactly true in my life too. I prayed for the answers and I thought if I could just get well, from other things as well as anxiety and depression, that, I too will give back. And so I think it's marvelous and empowering when people do that. And I don't want to keep going on and on, but truthfully, Lucinda Bassett has always been somebody I very much admired, and I would call her more than a mentor. I would call her a hero of mine. And so now, without further ado, I'd like to welcome to this program Lucinda Bassett. Welcome, and how are you today?
I'm good. I just don't know how to follow that. That was just such a gift. Thank you so much for all of that. I'm glad that it's had such a great effect in your life, you know.
Oh, well, yeah, and, you know, I really didn't want to go on too much about it, but it just, there was no way I could speak to you, do this interview, or do it or your work justice without saying that, you know, you're somebody who, you so changed my life. And so, you know, I'm so excited to get to interview you. I was excited to see you have yet another book out that's, you know, it's hard to compare books, but, I mean, I think this one is even more incredible than your others. And I'm just thinking, you know, how many people will come across this show who might maybe not be listening live right now, those listening live, wonderful too, but in the archives, and how many more people you can reach and help. And so, you know, I talked a bit about what was on your site there, you know, and how you've described yourself in your bio, but I was just wondering if you could share with us a little today, maybe a synopsis of, you know, what it was really like for you, what you were really going through up until that time when you found out that, you know, what you were experiencing was, A, not just you, and, B, it had a name.
Well, you know, I had severe anxiety as a child, as you know, and panic attacks as a teenager, and no one diagnosed it. I really thought I was going crazy, and I felt like I couldn't talk to my mother. Certainly couldn't talk to my father because he was, you know, consistently drinking and not really present. And then I entered school, college, and I started studying nursing. And I just got to the point where I couldn't sit comfortably in class. I couldn't fly on a plane. It was difficult for me to be in a car with other people. And my anxiety just became so overwhelming, it actually became agoraphobia, which is where you start avoiding doing things because you're afraid you're going to have the symptoms, which, as you described so perfectly, you know, you just feel panicky. You're just afraid you're going to die. You're afraid you're going to stop breathing. You just want to run. And I have to say, sitting here now, thinking about all of that, listening to you, it seems like so long ago because the book, The Solution, that just came out is really the reason for that book is that about 3 years ago, here I am, the anxiety lady, you know, really able to handle difficult situations, and I was put in a situation I will call the perfect storm where my anxiety skills were really tested because I lost my husband of 25 years to a sudden death, and then I had to sell part of my business, and then my brother passed away suddenly, and then 6 months later I lost my mother. And that was all 3 years ago, and that was a really tough experience, still is, but ironically, it was right before the economy started to turn, and a lot of people in the last 3 years have gone through tremendous anxiety and challenge and change and loss as a result of all the changes globally and in the economy. And so looking around, I realized that people needed help. And I thought, I've been through something so horrific in the last, you know, 3 years ago, and I've managed to pull myself out of it and learn new skills that I had never been forced to find before. And I thought this would be just a really wonderful time to share this with people because everyone was looking for something. And that was the reason for the book, The Solution.
Wow, and, you know, just my condolences on your losses and that, what just, you know, must have been just a horrific time and a stressful time in your life, because I must say that when I was doing a little research for this interview, I mean, I came across the story, you know, of your husband's passing, and I just thought, wow, you know. And so how much of what you'd already learned, you know, I mean, how much did that help you through that most difficult time in your life?
Well, it certainly helped me, but I think what it didn't do for me is, what I needed to go out and find was I didn't understand the power of a core story, what you went through as a child, and I didn't understand the power of what is your biggest fear. Because once my husband passed away, and then I lost my brother, and then I lost my mother, and I really, my husband and I were very, very close. We were not only husband and wife, but we have two children, and we had a very tight family, and he was my business partner. And then my mother was my biggest fan next to my husband. When I lost her, I mean, after losing my brother, and I've already lost all my other siblings except for one, I was just really overwhelmed, and a spiritual guru came to me and said to me, you know, Lucinda, what is your biggest fear? And I said, fear, I'm afraid to be alone. I said, that's always been my biggest fear. I don't want to be alone. And when I got to talking to this person, I realized it was very much connected to my core story. And he said to me, God has brought you this life lesson because this is so powerful in your life, and it's something you need to work through and share with other people. And if someone would have told me 3 years ago that I would have written this new book and that I would be alone and okay and getting on with my life, I would have said, no way. I remember a moment when I came into my office in my home after David had died, and I had just written a product for QVC, and I was just so upset and overwhelmed by, you know, just the bigness of losing my husband and my mother and selling my part of my company and my brother. It was just too much. And my son came in, and he was 16, and he had lost his father, you know, and he said to me, Mom, you can do this. You created this product without Daddy, and you're Lucinda Bassett, and, you know, you'll get through this. And I remember standing there thinking, wow, if this is the gift, you know, that my son, you know, can come to me and share this with me, this is an amazing gift, you know, that I'm getting from him. So I wanted to share what I've had to learn to pull myself up out of this darkness and go on with my life and live, and all the guilt and the anger and the fear that comes with this huge void. And I've done it, and so that's why I wrote this book, The Solution, because so many people right now are feeling loss and challenge and change in their life, and it's a program that if you go through this book, I really feel that you'll be empowered, that so you're in a situation where that no matter what's going on around you, you're stronger than you've ever been, and you will get through it.
Yeah, I just wonder how much in general. I think it's interesting how you came to identify, you know, that you weren't as aware of your core story. Because I think, you know, a lot of people aren't until, like, life really challenges us to get in touch with, hey, what's really going on down deep here? Because loss, like you've been through, and we all have loss in life, everything is obviously, you know, going to be challenging and going to teach us lessons. But how do you think it is that so many people are living their lives, going through their lives, without really being attached to or aware of this core story?
Well, I think that people go through their lives, and in the book I talk about something being, there are two very powerful concepts that I share in the book. It's the one is this whole core story experience and the importance of going back and looking at your core story, and the other one is going from being a reactive person, and that's so important. You are reactive because whatever you learned in your core story, well, whatever was embedded to you about financial responsibility or intimacy or relationships or financial security or parenting, that's going to carry with you. And when you're an adult, you're going to react to things in a very spontaneous way that comes natural to you. It's called reactive living. And it's not good because you might be someone who's good at being angry, or you might be someone who's good at blame, or seeing yourself as a victim, or someone who's afraid of risk, or someone who's not good with money. And all of this is coming from your core story. And when you understand that that's where it comes from, then you'll understand that you can not necessarily get rid of the core story, but you can turn it into something that is proactive. In other words, how can you take what you've been through in your core story, good and bad, and be proactive? And what I mean by proactive is the successful people in life are proactive people, and I give you a lot of examples of those people in the book. They're people that when they're faced with challenge or loss, they don't sit around and feel like a victim. They actually say, okay, what can I do right now to turn this into something positive? What can I do to fix things? What can I do to be proactive so that I can take action steps to get a better end result? And that's what the book teaches you how to do.
Yeah, and I just wonder, too, if you know, getting in touch with a core story and, you know, learning the difference between reactive versus proactive, I mean, isn't that kind of where fear and anxiety become big blocks?
Yes, and so much of those fear and anxiety blocks are from the core story. But if you take a look at it and you say, okay, I mean, my core story was I grew up with an alcoholic father who didn't believe in success, and in fact, he was angry with people who had nice things and bad-mouthed them and said, you know, they're materialistic, they, you know, all they care about is money, and they're righteous, and they're this, and they're that. So, of course, I grew up thinking having nice things was bad, you know, and I carried that core story with me for a long time, and I worked two jobs in high school, and I did everything I could to give myself some kind of financial security, but every time I went out and had anything nice, I felt bad about it, and it wasn't until my older sister, Donna, went out, worked, bought a beautiful home, and I'll never forget her butter sofas in her living room, and I thought, wow, our family can have nice things, and it's not something you need to feel bad about. And she helped me change my core story. But the other side of that is that a lot of that core story experience, you know, I was the baby in the family. I was the one that went around, tried to fix people and make things better and make everyone laugh and tried to heal things and bring home the sick animals. And I'm using all that now in what I do for a living. So there's a way to take that negative core story and your positive core story and use it now in your present day experience to go out and take risks and build a better future. And the book does a beautiful job of helping you understand what's beautiful about you because of your core story experience. You know, Native Americans believe you go through challenge and change to learn. You know, in our culture, we think you need to take medication or drink yourself away from it, and that's not true. What you really need to do is learn from it. You do need to let go of the pain and move beyond it, but you need to use it as a tool to help you build a better life for yourself and your family. And these are life lessons that are brought to you, I believe, spiritually and universally to help you address the very essence of your core story and your biggest fears.
Yeah, and what part, you know, between the core story and, like, becoming aware of it and starting to, like, actualize proactivity, if I can put it that way, in your life, what about self-sabotage? I mean, how much is, anxiety experience and worry thoughts and all those kind of ways of thinking, how much of that is self-sabotage, and what is really the purpose of that?
Well, the purpose of that, believe it or not, again, goes back to your biggest fear. The reason we sabotage and your core story. That's why this book is just, I think, did you read the book, The Solution?
Yes.
And what did you think? I heard you say you thought it was one of the best yet. That just made me feel so good because that's how I feel. I think this book's so necessary. I think it should go out to everybody. If I could, I'd give everyone a copy of it because what happens is we go through life, as you said, sabotaging our dreams, sabotaging relationships, sabotaging our success, sabotaging our financial security and our future. And we don't even know we're doing it. We do it by being negative or by drinking too much or by, you know, thinking of the glass is half full or thinking that we don't have any potential or blaming it on the fact that we didn't graduate from high school or college or whatever it is, you know. And what it really goes back to is that core story experience. You know, who told you that you weren't good enough? Whom led you to believe that you have to have a college degree? Who led you to believe that you're not smart or you're not creative or you're not worthy? Who led you to believe that there's no such thing as a really good, healthy, loving marital relationship? Because these are beliefs that you have that you carry from your core story that you can change. They're your core beliefs. And so it's really about working in this 21-day emotional makeover that this book provides to change those beliefs so that you can go out and establish real, true, new beliefs about yourself that will help you actually create what you want to happen in your life.
Well, yeah, I mean, and I know that when I was reading the book, and because I was familiar with your earlier work and other books, I could really see something very, very different in this and very more, I don't know how to explain, but just, well, not even just more practical, because you've always been very practical, but there's just a wisdom to it, you know, just a sort, and it is such a sort of a step-by-step guide. It's not just a book that you read. It's like a journey that you take.
Right, right, and that really is what it is. It's something that most people have never done. It's a way of looking at your past and who you are now very intimately it's almost like a good workout with a really great trainer. When you first start, if you've never been to the gym, you start working out and you say, oh my gosh, this is so painful and I just don't know if I can do it. And that's kind of what the initially you open the book and you go, oh my gosh, this is so painful. And yet you can't stop reading it. It's like, oh my gosh, I had this book laying around my book in my house over the holidays, and I only had one copy. And everyone who came to visit would start reading it, and they picked up and start walking out the door with it. And I'm like, wait, I need that book. And they're like, I can't put it down. It's like a cold slap in the face of reality. I've never looked at myself this way. I mean, the first chapters, I love how it unfolds about all these people who've never graduated from high school, never went to college. And we're talking about Harvard professors and political figures and amazing people, very, very wealthy people, who, as a result of their core story, not in spite of it, and you see that's the difference, have gone on to be highly successful in their lives and gone on to help millions of people or gone on to be wonderful parents. And it's all as a result of, you know, them being proactive in their life versus being reactive. But we don't have a roadmap, and that's why this book is so helpful, because it's so motivating from the very first chapter. And yes, it is a journey. There are 21 days of action assignments and all these proactive attitude adjustments that you really get it. You know, by about two-thirds of the way through the book, you're going, wow, I get it. I totally get it. I've been thinking wrong and reacting spontaneously, inappropriately, for my whole life, and I'm going to do it differently. And the book doesn't just help you go, okay, this is what's wrong with me. It tells you how to fix what's wrong with you.
Yeah, isn't the other thing about this that's important to remember when you're reading this, because, you know, there's some pain involved in growth and being educated and learning how to be proactive and be more authentic and all of that. But, you know, isn't there some truth to the fact that we have to be willing to, you know, we need to want to take the journey. Like, what can possibly be gained from continuing to choose to suffer, I guess? You know, because I think there's a lot of people out there who still kind of stay stuck in the victim role, and they kind of still are choosing to suffer.
Wow, you really know, you know, this subject, and I really appreciate that, and you're right on. And as you probably remember from reading the book From Panic to Power and doing the program, what's to be gained from suffering? Well, that's what we call secondary gains. And believe it or not, people think, I'm not getting anything out of being miserable. Oh, yes, you are. You're justifying why you're unhappy. You're justifying why you can't change. You're justifying why nobody understands you, why you're a victim. You're justifying why you can't get what you want out of life. You're justifying so many things. And that's really unfortunate, because it will keep you stuck. And if you just change that victim behavior and that victim thinking, because that's really what it is. It's like, I'm a victim. I have no power. Yes, you do. And I don't care if you're 21 or 61. You hold the power in your brain and your mind and the way that you choose to be affected by what's happening.
Yeah, which, of course, like you said before, does go back to connecting to your core story, to kind of look at, you know, where did all this stuff and thinking come from. And, you know, many people who are stuck in, and they don't even often realize it's a choice of suffering and remaining a victim. I mean, they may well have been victimized in the past, but the thing is, you know, we have to move on from that, right?
You not only have to move on from it, you don't want to forget it, because it's power. And it's like I talk in the book about how you can use fear as a prison that's going to hold you captive and keep you stuck, or you can use it to fuel the fire and motivate you to move forward. So, you know, I could sit around and worry about becoming an alcoholic, and I could sit around and worry about being a bag lady, because we were very poor. My father was an alcoholic, and he used his alcohol to self-medicate for his depression. But because of living with that, I've chosen not to drink. You know, I don't not drink at all, but I don't drink much. I've chosen not to be an alcoholic. I've chosen to be financially responsible and teach my kids financial responsibility. So instead of sitting around and worrying that I might end up like my father and like my core story experience, I've used that fear to motivate myself to make sure that doesn't happen. Now, that's easier said than done. There's a way to do it. And to think you can just do that on your own, some people do, but most people can't. It's like learning how to speak Spanish. You know, I could say, come with me, you know, to Mexico and be my interpreter. And if you've never spoken Spanish, you can't do it. you have to learn how to become a proactive thinker, and that's the skill that you learn in the book, The Solution.
Yeah, and I was just thinking, too, you know, like, along with not many people who don't sort of have an awareness of their core story, you know, I wonder how come people then sort of substitute other people's beliefs of them along with their own maybe negative thinking, but, you know, in continuing to sort of not want to know who they are. And I know there's so many powerful things in this book that you've just written, but one thing that I just, you know, will admit that just knocked me right over was when you wrote about the fraud syndrome. I just wonder if you could speak a little bit to that, because I just thought that was incredibly empowering among everything else. It's empowering in this book.
Well, there's two things I want to address there, and I'll come back to the fraud syndrome. Don't let me forget. But first, you said, why do we hang out with people who, I'm going to rephrase it a little bit, reinforce our negative beliefs about ourselves, right? And that's because we hang around with toxic people if we grew up with toxic people, because even though they're toxic, it feels familiar. So we hang around with people who will reinforce our core story beliefs subconsciously, because that's what we're comfortable with. It's like the woman who keeps dating toxic abusive men, even if they're just verbally abusive, because maybe her father was verbally abusive. You know, she's not comfortable with a man who says, you're beautiful, I love you, and worships and adores her, because she's used to a man who abused her verbally or didn't think she was worth anything or didn't know how to compliment her. So we tend to gravitate toward our core story experience again until we go, wow, and we realize that it's not good. Then we can start choosing different types of people to hang out with. And the fraud syndrome also goes back to the core story. It's so amazing. It's like, you know, you get out there and you start becoming successful. And let's just say, if you read my book, it's funny. I went looking for people that had these, you know, successful lives in spite of, and I'll say that, what they'd been through and their core story. And what I found is thousands of people. I was overwhelmed at the people who went on and lived huge, big, successful, happy, giving, sharing, loving lives, not in spite of their core story, but because of their core story. And that's such a different way to look at it. But the fraud syndrome steps in there as a sabotage syndrome. So when you do finally stick your little toe out there and say, maybe I grew up poor, but maybe I can be financially responsible. Nobody in my family went to college, but maybe I can go to college. Or maybe you're out there and you're really successful, but you didn't go to college, and your core story is speaking to you going, you didn't go to college, you came from a poor family, you're a loser, and you know it. And so you're afraid people will find out that you're really not who you are putting out there now. You're really the core story person that you were when you were younger. But you're not. You know, you're who you are now, and you don't need to be ashamed of that core story anymore. In fact, embrace it, as the Native Americans say, because it's part of who you've become. If I wouldn't have grown up in a dysfunctional family with a violent man as a father who was an alcoholic, I wouldn't be Lucinda Bassett, the self-help person right now. I really wouldn't be. If I would have grown up in a stable environment with great parents who taught me the value of, you know, of independence and financial responsibility and told me I was wonderful and loved me dearly, and my mother did. But if my father would have been that way, I wouldn't have grown up to be who I am now, and who knows what I would be doing. Maybe I'd be, you know, selling real estate. I don't know, you know. But my point is, because of what I went through, I am capable of feeling other people's pain. I understand when someone struggles with severe anxiety. I understand when someone tells me, you know, they've lost their husband at an early age. I lost mine, you know. I understand what it means, you know, to be tortured with emotional suffering, because I was. And because of all of that, I'm good at what I do, and I can help people. And, you know, it's been a real gift for me, but it all comes from understanding your core story.
Well, right, and I think, you know, one of the reasons why I was just saying how this one particular part, along with other parts of your book, hit me, the fraud syndrome, was, you know, I've been one of those people, I guess I connected with part of my core story too, but, you know, the thinking that, oh, if you don't have a degree, how could you possibly have anything, like, you know, important enough to say? You know, and I think there's probably examples of a lot of successful people out there who must have had to go through those kind of thoughts to get to the other side.
Well, the truth is, if you read my book, and as you know, the first chapter opens up with, I think there's probably 40 people, I don't know. I went looking for a couple, and I was so blown away by people like, you know, Winston Churchill and, you know, some, like I said, the, some of the people in there that are, you'll just be shocked when you find out they don't have a college degree. Like I said, there's Harvard professors, there's incredible writers, there's people who, you know, who make some of the most powerful movies in the world. There are political figures, there are, I mean, governors, there's, you know, the chief of police for Washington, D.C. I mean, and you sit back and you say, you know, Tom Brokaw, I believe, you know. I mean, there are so many people who never even graduated from high school. Richard Branson, who founded, you know, he's a multi-billionaire, founded Virgin Airlines, quit high school at 16. Am I saying you should? No. Am I saying you shouldn't go to college? Absolutely not. But am I saying at 40 years old, if you don't have a college degree, is that your excuse for not being successful? Nope, that one doesn't work. Find another. Mm-hmm. It's really your attitude. And, you know, you can be articulate, well-spoken, and professional, and highly successful, and never have even graduated from high school. It's about who you are. It's about how far you push yourself. It's about your belief in yourself. And if anybody that judges you because of your degrees, you know, move on. Because, I mean, there are certain things you certainly have to have a degree for. You're not going to perform brain surgery if you, you know, if you're not an MD. But many, many things in life don't require a degree. And how many people do we know with PhDs who've never amounted to anything? It's about your moxie and your belief in yourself and your confidence and your desire to be successful.
Yeah, and so what? And what would you say to people who, and I don't know if I should link these two together, but it seems to me they kind of go together. But you know, fear of failure, fear of success.
Oh man, you know, people who are afraid of success are again, it is related to the core story. Fear of success is all about, you know, it's a couple of things. Number one, can I handle it? Can I handle the overwhelm? Can I handle the change? Can I handle the responsibility? Will my husband still love me if I'm working 60 hours a week? Will I still be a good mother if I really take this job and I'm not around the way I need to be? So there's all this guilt that comes with it. And fear of failure is just, you know, huge. It's, and that just expands into so many areas of your life, fear of failure. That's why, you know, that's why so many relationships don't work. There are so many people who are afraid it won't work, but they don't even want to get into one. And so they just don't. And that's really unfortunate. It's why people choose not to be parents. It's why people choose not to be successful in life. They're afraid they'll fail. And failure is a scary thing. And yet, any successful person will tell you they failed a million times. You know, your greatest gifts and lessons in life come from failure and loss. And so it's not something you avoid, it's something you embrace.
Yeah, I think there's a quote, I can't remember whose it is, but like success is failure turned inside out.
Yeah, that's true. That's a good one, yeah.
Because, you know, yeah, we have to learn somehow. But I think that people, you know, I wonder, do you have any comment to make on how it is that, I'm going to say society, I think this is a sort of a global thing right now, how do we end up to be, and I know core story is a big part of it, but such negative thinkers if we're not careful. Why is it so much easier, it seems, for so many people to think the negative instead of to think the positive?
Because for most people, it's the way they were brought up. And the other thing is, we are bombarded every day with negative messages and negative thinking. And unfortunately, in our society right now, you know, it's constant bombardment of what's happening not only in our country and all around the world. Now it's global, and it's all fear. And then there are the messages that you're not good enough unless you're stick thin and you have beautiful teeth and, you know, you don't need to wear glasses anymore. And, you know, and you, it's all about all these images that are put out there in magazines and television shows. You know, The Biggest Loser. I mean, you know, it's a great show in some ways. People lose weight and get their health back, but just look at the title, you know, The Biggest Loser. I mean, you know, there are shows on TV that we are, it's like Dexter and CSI, and people are glued to their television sets watching this violent, horrific, heinous acts. And then I'm sure you've heard about what happened in Tucson here, and you wonder why 22-year-old men are capable of doing things they're capable of doing. But look at the video games and the music. Listen to the music and look at the TV shows and the movies that are out there. The exposure to negative thinking and negative energy and negative, you know, media is so intense that it's just kind of, how much do you hear about that's positive, loving, and good?
Yeah, not near enough, eh?
No, not near enough, and that's why.
I was just going to say too, as you mentioned, you know, the Tucson tragedy. It's sort of like, you know, and then they had a bit of a debate there in the American media for a while about, you know, could it be the political, you know, the state of political discourse and whatnot. And, you know, I think it's already starting to fade, and yet I guess that would go to a question of civility, though, because why do people have to be so critical of each other? And, again, it's that negative reinforcement and, I guess, how they feel about themselves. But it's all this tearing down and separating from, instead of, you know, like, really, we're all more alike than we're different, aren't we? And wouldn't it be wonderful if we could just all take ownership for our core stories and empower ourselves so, you know, we can turn to the next person and empower them too, instead of all this tearing down.
You know, you just said that's so true. And in the last part of my book, The Solution, I talk about your life's mission. And I talk about how important it is to, I really do believe, you know, my sister passed away 10 years ago, which was really terrible too. And I remember when she died and I thought, who's here for me? Because she was always here for me. And God, this voice just came over. I was on this turbulent flight going to her funeral. And God said, you know, we're all here for each other. And I really do believe that. And I think part of your mission is to go through your experience and use it to reach out to somebody else. And maybe it'll be your own children. Maybe it'll be, you know, your mother-in-law. Maybe it'll be the woman in an elevator. You know, that's what I've found. It's like we are all here for each other. And what you go through, if you can use it to touch someone else, that's a powerful thing. And you don't have to be out there writing books about it, but if you want to, go for it. But, you know, if you're someone, who better to talk to a mother who's lost her child, which to me, you know, I mean, I lost my husband and I lost my siblings and I've lost my mother and father, and it's all horrific. But I mean, I can't imagine losing a child. And, you know, who better to help a mother deal with that than a mother who's lost a child? Who better to tell a woman how to get through the loss of her husband than someone who's lost her husband? Who better to tell someone how to deal with cancer than someone who's dealt with cancer? And so if you have, you know, the most valuable gift you have to give anyone is your time, because we're all so busy and it's so easy not to give your time. You know, all right, well, maybe I'll help them out financially. Maybe I'll give them a book to read. Maybe I'll tell them my therapist's name. No, sit with them. Listen to them. Tell them what you've been through. That's the biggest gift you can give anyone. And I think that's why what I've done has helped so many people and touched so many people. I'm not a PhD. I'm one of those people who God has brought to my knees over and over again, and I get through it, and I get up, and I get going, and then I share it with other people, and it's real, and it's there. And, you know, I don't want to hear from someone how to deliver a 10-pound baby unless you've delivered a 10-pound baby. I don't want to hear how to have a marriage of 25 years unless you've done that, you know. I mean, and so I'm here to tell you, I've gone through extreme anxiety and depression and extreme challenge, change, and loss in the past 3 years beyond, you know, my wildest imagination. And I've had to really, there's one chapter in my book about detaching and the power of positive detachment. It was the hardest chapter for me to write because I've lost so much in the last 3 years, you know, and yet I wrote this chapter, and I think it's so powerful, and so many people in the last 3 years have had to detach from their financial security, you know, maybe from their family homes, possibly from their jobs or a career that they love, or, you know, even possibly from a relationship, because what happens is when you struggle financially, it affects your health. And those two things are so important. And then when you're not healthy and you're struggling financially, then it affects your relationships, because then you get nasty or angry or depressed or frightened. And then it affects your relationship. And then so now you're financially struggling, you don't feel good, and your relationship is struggling, and then it affects your children. And it's all very hard. And I feel so grateful to be able to have an offering for people that I really believe will help them in these turbulent times, and that's this book.
Well, and you know, this book is like, you know, it's hard to say this because all your work is so powerful, but this probably is the most powerful yet. Do you think?
I think it is. I really feel good about it. And one of the reasons I feel so good about it is because there's so much in there that's new and different, and I love the stories of the people. And I think that you open this book up, and you are at the very beginning, you go, wow. And I think that it's a unique book, and I think that when you're done reading it, you really do have a different way of looking at yourself and at life and of your potential. And I don't think it matters where you came from, how old you are, where you live. I think this book has the power to really, you know, motivate you and help you change so that you can become proactive in the way that you live your life. And you know, the book is
doing... And I was just looking at, I think it's on page 260, you have in under the power of prayer, on day 20 in the proactive action, and the assignment is, this action assignment is called Become Your Own Hero. And, you know, I just thought that was so interesting because, you know, and I don't want to overstate this, and honest to God, usually I'm not, you know, but I have to tell you this, that as I see you as having been a hero of mine, you know, that this part of the book reaffirmed this for me too, but, you know, you certainly have taught me how to become my own hero. I mean, this is, you know, how incredibly life-changing your work and this particular book especially is, and I don't know, I just needed to say that to you because, you know, this is just incredible, incredible stuff. And I think one of the things that was so amazing for me about experiencing your work, and as I talked about in the beginning, you know, way back in the early 90s when somebody dragged into my therapy group one of your videos, and I thought, oh, no, and it wasn't you. It would have, you know, it could have been anybody's video. It was my attitude at the time, right? And then what happened when I actually, you know, as soon as I started to hear you talk on the video, it was like, the thing that really hit me was, wow, you know, here's somebody who's lived it. You know, here's somebody who's not, so it's kind of like what you've been talking about. It's not just somebody saying, well, you know, this would be a good idea or check this out, but you really know because you've really been there. And so, you know, I was just looking at this page, Be Your Own Hero, and how important that is, and because I think that you are a great example of that.
Well, I really appreciate that, and it's very kind of you. And that be your own hero segment to me too is very important. And I just want to take that a step further. It's like, think today, if you're listening, and think about someone in your life that you just really think is wonderful. In other words, maybe you look at them and you think they're always in a good mood, they're always pleasant, they're very loving, they stay calm, they always seem to underreact to things. And they're a giver, you know, and they're happy, they're living in the moment, and they just feel, and this is not this, very many times, this is not someone with a lot of money. This is someone who's just your average income, you know, kind of just a person who just seems to be at peace with themselves. And you seem to look at them and say, gosh, I wish I could be more like them. That could be your hero, that person. And you can take elements of different people, like I like this about her, and I like this about him, and I like this about this person. And it's good to sit down and write out what you like about that person and then aspire to be more like them. And the best people to learn from are people who are doing or being the way that you would like to do or be, you know?
Yeah, and I think oftentimes, I mean, I think what I first saw and learned from you, saw in and through you was, you know, something that was proactive when I was in a, you know, excuse me, back then in my life, I was definitely still entrenched in, you know, the victim of my core story. And I think, too, that, you know, on page 263 here, you've written about, yeah, there's just so much in this book, but when you talked about Rick Warren, who's the author of, you know, Minister and A Purpose-Driven Life, can you speak a bit about that part, you know, and what he had to say? Because I think it's what we were talking about a few minutes ago about how, you know, we can really all improve our own lives, lot in lives, and accomplishing, you know, knowing our authentic self and being fulfilling purpose and promise and passion, being there for each other, and that he says a lot about this.
You know, one of the things he says, and I repeat it in my book, is that painful experiences are used to prepare us for our own personal ministry. And he also says, at some point in your life, you need to decide whether you want to impress people or influence people. I just think that's so beautiful. You can impress from a distance, but to influence someone, you need to get close to them. And when you do, they'll be able to see your flaws, and that's okay. And happiness is only available with total acceptance of who you are, including all your fears, your worries, and your anxieties. And I really believe that we go through these difficult challenges so that we can, you know, share that with others, and especially our children, you know. And you don't want your children to see that when you're stressed out or you're anxious or you're depressed, you know, you reach for a pill bottle or a glass of wine or you scream at them, or you want them to see that you can cope. The best thing you can do is stay calm. And in the book, I talk about all these different skills. One of my favorite ones is worry reversal. You tend to do what you've always done. As I said, if you're an angry person, when you're in a situation that's challenging, you're going to get angry. If you're a worrier, you're going to worry. If you are someone who feels victimized, you're going to find someone to blame. And one of the best things you can do when something happens is not do anything, is take a 24-hour timeout, sit back and say, okay, I'm angry, or I'm worried, or I'm upset. I'm going to take 24 hours before I respond to this. And that gives you 24 hours to really think it through and use some proactive planning so that you can say to yourself, why am I angry? What am I worried about? How is this coming from my core story? How do I need to change this so I can be proactive so whatever I'm worried about doesn't happen, or whatever I'm angry about I can diffuse? Or so, you know, and so much of what we do is, I want to say, contagious. And I believe that if you're going to put something out there and have other people be affected by it or infected by it, why not put out the good stuff? The simplest things, one of the most powerful gifts we have to give to anybody is the power of being complimentary and positive in their life, a positive influence in their life. It's so easy, and very few of us do it. And it's done just by simply loving them or holding them or spending time with them or complimenting them with things, you know, hey, you look beautiful today, or I just love that tie on you. It just brings out the color in your eyes, or I'm so proud of you. You got your homework done, or, you know, you are just an amazing daughter because I hear you talking to your friends and I hear the support that you give them, and you're so good at talking to people. Or, you know, instead of beating people up, you know, build people up. And it's a gift that you can give for free, and I believe that's all part of our ministry, getting back to that, you know. Part of our job is to be here for each other.
Well, and I think, too, that, you know, as people beat themselves up, then, of course, you know, how are they going to be able to support people? They usually end up at least mentally beating others up. And I'm just wondering, you know, what would you say about, or how would you speak to the concept of control and, you know, what we really need to learn about that?
Well, the most powerful lesson to be learned about control is to understand that you don't have control, and that's okay. And that's probably the most effective method of controlling your emotions about control, is to relinquish it. And because the truth is, the only thing you really have control over is you. The only thing you really can control is how you're affected by something. It's hard, pretty darn hard, to control another person. You can attempt it, but it'll make you very frustrated. It's very hard to control situations that are out of your control, like the economy, the housing market, unemployment. But you can choose how you're affected by it. Certainly there are things you can control. You can control, you know, what you're going to do today to some degree, and whether or not you're going to work out, and if you're going to brush your teeth tonight, and whether or not you're going to make dinner for the family. But can you control things that are out of your control, which is, by the way, probably 90% of the things around you and outside of you? No. And so true control comes with letting go of trying to control everything and everyone around you and trusting God. And I mean, I really do believe that so much power comes in be still. You know, if you're worried, be still. Trust God, trust the universe, trust yourself, trust your power to maintain, and let time pass. And see where it's at in 2 days. Everything doesn't have to be addressed today and fixed right now. And, you know, we are all going 90 miles an hour, and we're in such a hurry, and we want everything to be fixed and be better and be right and be stable. And, you know, you can't fix things that quickly. So sometimes you just have to go inside and be still and trust that inner voice and trust the universe. And certainly you need to continue to, you know, work toward taking care of yourself and being responsible and moving forward in your life and planning for the future. But sometimes you really do just need to be still and not react, and certainly not overreact. I talk about being an underreactor, you know, because more than likely, if you're someone who's highly stressed and worried all the time, you are an overreactor. And it's so effective and powerful to underreact instead of overreact. And it's such a good example to set for your children.
Yeah, so I guess really, you know, when it comes to the issue and challenge of control at times or whatever, that's really what you address, you know, in your healthy detachment section of this book, right?
Yes.
I mean, that's another thing to sort of be detached from, really, isn't it?
It really is, and I think that book about the chapter, I want to say the chapter about detachment's worth the price of the book, but I just think the book, that first chapter is so great too. I don't know, I just think that that detachment is such a powerful word, and it scares people. And in the book, I talk about when you need to detach. And I think that's so powerful, that paragraph. It's like when you just can't stop thinking about the person or the thing, and you're obsessing about it and worrying about it and thinking about it every minute, and you just feel this huge fear that if you lost it, it would just make you crazy and you just couldn't live without it. And that's when it feels the most impossible thing to do is when you most need to do it. And people are afraid to detach because they are so dependent. And for me, and my fear of being alone, detaching is still very hard for me. I've lost so many people in my life and so many things that I've had to let go of. And it's just hard, you know, but the more I've done it, the easier it gets. And I think the most important thing to detach from is people who just aren't good for you. And that's hard, you know, because it might be family members, or it might be someone, it might be a boyfriend or a husband, or, you know, or a dysfunctional person in your life who drains you and hurts you and makes you feel bad. And yet you cling to them because you're scared to be alone. And or maybe you're in a job that's not good for you, and you're afraid to let go because you're afraid there's nothing else out there for you. But what I've learned in my own life is until you let go, those other doors aren't going to open. You know, you may be holding on to a toxic man in your life, but until you let him go, a great man's not going to be able to come into your energy space. So detachment is hugely important to allow other wonderful windows to open in your life.
Well, yeah, and I think, too, that if we're not working on it, and maybe, you know, detaching is to some degree an ongoing process, but if we're not detaching, then we, you know, whatever we may be remaining attached to, right, I mean, is that maybe not just a definition of how to be stuck with, you know, whatever it might be, anxiety, depression, worry, panic attacks, all of that?
That's right. That's a really good point. I mean, the more you cling to the negative energy in your life, whether it's people or situations or emotions, the more you draw that into your life and keep yourself stuck in it. And you've heard the saying, you know, misery loves company, okay? That's true. And negative people tend to hang out with negative people. And it all goes back to that core story. So, you know, until you understand and recognize that your negative way of living and your negative thinking is an addictive bad habit, kind of like smoking, and you say, I want to break this habit and I want to change and I want to live a healthier life, until you recognize that, you won't. And so it's extremely important that you understand that it's an addictive bad habit, and you make the commitment to break it, and you make the commitment to replace it with good habits, good ways of thinking, healthy, positive people, and healthy behaviors in your life.
Mm-hmm. And I'm just wondering if you can, you know, if you recall, because obviously there's so much in this book, but you gave an interesting example about Neil Donald Walsh, who is the author of Conversations with God. I just wondered if, you know, you can recall a bit about what his example, his story was about.
Oh, you know, right off the top of my head, I can't. That's one you just threw me with. So tell me, you know, what page you're on or where you're at there.
Oh, page 145.
Okay, I'm telling you, there's so much in here that I went out and researched, and I went, oh, my gosh, this is fabulous.
I was going to say, you know, for you not to recall that right away doesn't surprise me, because this book is just full of so, so very much. And it says that he suffered a series of shattering events and a fire that destroyed his belongings.
That's right. Well, you know, he wrote these great books. And he talks about, you know, when everything changes, change everything. Now, you know, he talks about breaking his neck in a car accident and having to go through rehab and all these things he went through. And now he has all these incredible books, and he's a best-selling author. And, you know, he's not a PhD, and he's someone that truly, he wrote all those books, Conversations with God. That's who he is. And he went through a horrific series of events, and I'm writing a new book right now called Emotional Muscle, which I open it up with a chapter about the perfect storm. And I'm going to call what he went through the perfect storm, and I'm going to call what I went through 3 years ago the perfect storm. It's a series of events that you go through that really are almost unbearable. And, you know, if you can get through them, they can be life-changing. But the question is, do you have the moxie, the emotional muscle, the stamina, the proactive attitude to get through those? And for some people who don't, they will force you to find them. And that's what happened to him. And here he's turned it into this whole series about conversations with God. And so it's just another example of someone. And there are 12 chapters, and I know 12 incredible examples of people with powerful stories such as his, if not more, who have gone through horrific things in life and have turned it into something very powerful and positive. Many of those people have gone on to help other people, which is what he's done.
Well, yeah, and I think in each and every person that you've, you know, given the examples of in here are amazing people. But that one, again, I just really related to, because I remember one day on a computer, I don't know how long ago now, coming across the audio of that and just being astounded at, you know, how much I learned in listening to, you know, what obviously he had learned from his life and what he was departing. Because, again, you know, I think people, maybe sometimes when people, you know, grow up, or as they're trying to grow up, or when we become adults, maybe we think we're supposed to know it all or something. But, you know, I think that the more that we can continue to be seekers, and the more we realize that no matter how much we know, there's incredible vast amount still that we can avail ourselves to learn. And if we can take the journey that way, then, you know, I don't know about other people, but I've certainly found it to be most rewarding to kind of think of it that way and to be open always to learning more. Because I think whether we realize it or not, you know, God, the universe, life certainly has that in store for us.
Right, that's true. And I think that it's all about what you decide to do with what you're giving, you know, with what you're given. And it's a choice that you make. You can use it to justify your lack of success and your misery, or you can use it to catapult you to a whole new place in your life. That doesn't mean you have to go out and be him, that you got to go out and be a writer or make, you know, go save the world. But it could just make you live a more pleasant daily life experience. It could make you a better parent, a better, you know, partner, a better employee or employer. And it could just make your daily life experience more positive. And especially during these times when we're so challenged and we're going through all these difficult experiences, so many people do need to really change their reaction to what's happening in the world, because this could go on for a while, you know. What are you going to do about it? How are you going to move forward and feel secure and safe and be responsible in spite of and because of what's happening in the world?
Yeah, and I just wonder if you have anything to say about the fact that, at least this is a belief of mine, but I don't want to get into all the politics of, you know, mental health and whatnot, but it just seems to me now that certain, you know, areas of the mental health profession are tending to pathologize almost in total the experience, you know, what it is to be human, and that it's not like there's this sort of, you know, all good and perfect way to be that I think sometimes people get caught up in thinking they're chasing versus, you know, taking life as it comes, and the fact that it's not in any one day in our lives is it going to come to us perfectly.
No, no, and, you know, again, that goes back to there's no such thing as perfect anyway. In my opinion, you know, what is happiness? Well, if you can get up and walk on your own two legs and go out there and choose what you're going to do today and feel financially secure to some degree and go to bed at night, put your head on the pillow and feel like, you know, you had a productive day and you have people in your life who love you, and personally, I feel like you have a relationship with God, whatever that is for you, then that's happiness, you know. I think it boils down to, first and foremost, good health for you and your family, and then secondly, a sense that you are financially safe in some way, whatever that means to you. And, you know, and that's something that I think that second one is what people are struggling with right now.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I am going to have to go pretty soon. I think I have another radio interview calling through. So I'm thinking they've got their time off a little bit, but that's what that beeping noise is.
Oh, I'm sure you're in popular demand, and as it should be, because this is an incredible book. And, you know, I certainly would urge anyone listening to go out and purchase it. And just in closing, and thank you so much for taking the time. And just in closing, I just wondered if you might want to just, I don't know, have a wrap-up thought or two about why you know people should go out and purchase your book, The Solution.
Well, I think that anyone and everyone would benefit from this book. But if you are going through challenges related to the times we're living in the world and the economy, and if you're having any kind of challenge, health issues, relationship issues, problems with your family, financial issues, you're just going to really, really benefit from this book. It's more than just enjoy the book. I mean, I think you're going to pick, what I've seen so far is people that pick this book up don't want to put it down, because you will read through the book and there are just so many things, from 13 different types of worriers and defining what type of worrier you are, to also really taking a serious look at your core story and understanding what your biggest fear is. But the real power of the book is the second half. The first half of the book is the problem and the second half of the book is the solution. And I really think that these proactive action assignments, they're meat and potatoes things that you actually go out and do that will change your life and change the way that you react and respond to what's happening in your life. So if you're someone who is sitting around going, I'm just not sure what to do, and I'm 50 years old and I'm going to have to change my career, or I don't feel financially secure, or I'm worried that my wife might leave me because I'm so stressed out, or I'm not sleeping at night, or maybe you're taking anti-anxiety medication or antidepressants, or running back and forth to the doctor complaining of stomach problems or headaches or nervousness. Whatever your issue is, I call this the solution for a reason. I really think you should go out and get this book. It's at Barnes & Noble stores, or there's all the bookstores in Canada. You can go to barnesandnoble.com, amazon.com, or you can check me out at lucindabassett.com. We have a website, midwestcenter.com, but I think this book should be in every family home. I think you should share it with your children, with your husband, your wife, your partner. I just think that it really has the potential to make 2011 a much better year for just about anybody.
Yeah, and I'll just add to that, too, for Canadians, Amazon.ca. And I just want to say, you know, I think that this book, it's incredible. It's everything you just said and more. And I look at it sort of, I've read it. I don't want it to be too far away from me. I'm going to keep looking back in there. I know I'm going to learn and keep learning. I look at it like it's a Bible of self-empowerment.
Wow, that's powerful. I really appreciate that. And if there's any way to link your interview to my site at the Midwest Center, or I just think this is, I've done probably hundreds of interviews, but this is one of the best ones I've done, and you have been incredible. You've done an incredible job, and you are an inspiration. So I just appreciate
it. Well, and I will provide you. I'll follow up with the person, your contact and email, and we'll get you the link, and you can put up the actual like player of the interview itself on whatever site you would like to.
You know what? If you send that to me today, I'll put it on my blog.
Oh, okay, great. So
people can go to the blog and click on and hear you. I'm sure I can get my guy to do that, because you are yourself such an inspiration, and I would just love people to connect with you too. So are you writing a book or anything?
Well, actually, I've written over 20 ebooks. I'm sort of in an ebook kind of like, you know, individualist mood right now. But I am working on a few things, and yeah, there'll be some things coming out soon. But I don't have a publisher right now, so I just keep self-publishing.
Well, you are a great lady, and you have a lot of wonderful energy, and you're doing great work here in what you're doing. And so I'm honored to be part of your show, and I really appreciate you having me on.
Well, thank you so much. And should I just email that information to the person that I've been emailing to, or is there somewhere else to email that to you?
I'll tell you what, you can email it to the person, and then they'll get it to my office. I'm not sure who you went through at this point. I've been on so many interviews, but if you email it to them, they'll get it to my office, and then Jim at my office will know how to hook it up. Yeah.
Okay, great. Well, and you know, just thank you so much for your time. Thank you so much for all the work you do, for how you've helped me in my life, and how you're helping so many others too. And I just send you blessings and wishings and strength and continued success and health and happiness, and looking forward to your next book.
Thank you so much, and the same to you, and I'll make sure you get a copy of the next book when it comes out.
Okay, great.
All right,
thanks so
take
much,
care.
And you take care now.
All right, thanks. Bye-bye.
Bye. And my guest today on the Psyche Whisperer Show was Lucinda Bassett, who, as we discussed, is the author of her newest book, The Solution, Conquer Your Fear, Control Your Future, a 21-day emotional makeover for taking control of your life. And you can check out more about Lucinda Bassett at lucindabassett.com, the Midwest Center website at stresscenter.com. And, we have also a couple links at psychewhisperer.com on the blog about this interview, to Lucinda's books, and also her Attacking Anxiety and Depression program, which is, I think it's probably in DVD now as well. It's definitely digital. It used to be on cassette, but now it's moved along with the times. And if you're struggling with these issues, I mean, this book really is, like I said, a Bible of self-empowerment, not in the religious sense, but just it's a tremendous asset for anyone dealing with fear. If you don't know what your core story is or what that means, or if you're not connected to your authentic self, if you need to know more about yourself, if you're stuck in old habits or patterns that aren't working for you, or toxic relationships, or you're feeling blocked or stuck, if you're just not being able to fully express who you are, who you know you're meant to be, if you know there's more for you in your life, then I highly recommend not only Lucinda Bassett's most recent book, The Solution, but her book, From Panic to Power, and reading more about her and her website, and, of course, keeping up with what's going on in the news of when her latest book will arrive also. She's a very inspiring woman, and like I said, I'm not just saying it for the sake of the interview. I did her Attacking Anxiety program years ago in my life, and it changed my life. So each and every one of us needs change from time to time, and we have to seek it. We have to want it. We have to take the risk. We have to know that change and growth does involve some pain, but that the greatest pain in life is continuing to choose in what is usually a subconscious, unconscious way, continuing to choose to suffer. And so with that, then, I'm just going to say, I hope that you found something in this interview and in this episode of the Psyche Whisperer Radio Show helpful, and I hope you'll continue to come back and check for upcoming shows and guests. And don't forget to check out our blog at psychewhisperer.com. And you can also check there for a link where you can join us on Facebook and keep abreast of the guests coming up on future episodes of the show.